Vast stands of ponderosa pine stretch across the Gila National Forest, a testament to the role of fire in this corner of the Southwest. For decades, fire managers on the Gila have been reintroducing fire back onto the landscape. While other forests are able to treat an average of 20,000 acres a year, the Gila regularly treats 50,000 acres with managed wildfire alone, and another 20,000 using prescribed fire. This level of success can be attributed to a culture on the Gila that encourages managers to allow fire to play its natural role on the land.
You know, we go back to the five rights. Well, it's about the right place and the right forest and the right conditions. And there was a time frame down there on the Gila when all those things came into place with leadership, with planning, with the use of fire, with prescribed fire skills and the practitioners that were down there.
Since the 1990s, the Gila's Black Range District has been one of the most innovative areas in the country for fire management. A series of fire management officers, including Dennis Fall, Toby Richards, and Robert Morales, has spurred innovative approaches to thinning and restoring forests using only fire.
And I still remember my first trip out here to Beaverhead and looking at all this pine, you know, and my first question was, oh, how much are you guys burning here per year? And the answer I got is none. You know, we haven't burned since we've been here, never. I go, are you serious? Look at this, then we can do a lot of good here. We developed this burn plan that covered 89,000 acres. We broke it up into 20 units ranging from 1,000 acres to about 8,000 acres.
And we've had at least four entries of prescribed fire in some of the 20 units that we've had. The initial entry might have been a little cooler. We tried to remove some of the heavier fuels off the ground. You know, there was 4 to 6 inches of pine needles underneath the big old pine trees, and we reduced that stuff out. And then the next entries, we get a little bit hotter and hotter, and we were pulling out or blowing out some holes in the pockets.
And in the process, we would basically make a mosaic pattern. We'd blow out some pockets, so we'd have groups of larger trees, and we'd still have some of the intermittent size trees along with some saplings coming up. And in a lot of places, you can really see that, where we would blow up in a few holes anywhere from a tenth acre in size to up to 5, maybe 10 acres on average, is where we'd really bring back that open grass, pine savanna type. We might have 200 trees per acre, for an example, and we'd reduce it down to 100 trees per acre, even 50 trees per acre, depending.
But this prescribed fire plan really, it allowed us the opportunity to get comfortable, learn how to do it. And then we moved to some pretty large fire use events.
The Gila has a long history of allowing wildfires to burn in the wilderness, starting with the Forest Prescribed Natural Fire Program in the 1970s and continuing with the Fire Use Program in the 1990s and early 2000s. The Black Range District, however, was one of the first areas in the country where large-scale fire use fires were allowed to burn outside of wilderness under carefully considered conditions and with a high level of planning.
So the significance of bringing wildfire outside of wilderness was really precedent setting in the Southwest area. That resulted in a whole new suite of values that we needed to protect. It resulted in bringing additional resources in to have those values protected. And I think it really set the stage for other forests in our region to look at that program and really realize and fully recognize that that could be them. That they opened up that, I think, that door.
Behind me is where the boiler fire came through in 2002, I believe it was. It was a 59,000 acre wildland fire use event. And we were able to manage the fire through pretty much the heat of the summertime. And what it turned into was like a 59,000 acre backing fire. So. It backed through this whole country you can see that I'm standing in and then behind me. And in the background, you could kind of see how wide open it is out there. And so the fire went through there and really reduced a lot of the ground fuels. It torched out a lot of trees, so we did a lot of thinning with fire in that area. And we were able to raise kind of the live low limb a lot of the trees out there, so make it a little bit more resistant to a catastrophic wild event.
The Black Range District also contains significant amounts of habitat for the Mexican spotted owl, as well as the Mexican gray wolf. Fire managers on the Black Range District have worked closely with wildlife biologists to integrate fire into wildlife management.
They're very willing to put forth the extra effort, and doing some of these management activities, it tends to involve much more planning or much more communication, and they're very willing to do some of that and try new things, because they do feel, I feel, and I think a lot of the fire folks feel here, that it is important, you know, to get fire into some of these areas that historically had fire, you know, regardless whether there's an owl or not. I mean, if it's good for the land, it, you know, should be good for the wildlife.
There was a vision that was set very early on that forest, and it's, for me, it started when Steve Service was the fire staff down there on the Gila National Forest. He had a vision, and this was in the early 90s, that on his forest, when he was a fire staff, that he would have a program where we would have fire that had multiple objectives, wildfire with multiple objectives. We would have fires that were unwanted, and we would have prescribed fire, and all those activities would be occurring concurrently. And so he set that vision up, and then we, at the time, there was leadership on that forest, starting with the forest supervisor and down to some really key rangers that embraced that vision. And they wanted to be the ones that got there first.
We were managing a fire use fire, at the time it was fire use fire, on the south side of the highway here. And we had just finished burning, 3,000-4,000 acre prescribed fire on the south side. And then we initial attacked like 5-6 fires within the area here that same day. And it hit me, you know, I go, Dennis, I go, do you realize what we just did today? And then, you know, because we had talked about it before, you go, oh, we lived a dream.
And then he's looking at me and I'm going, yeah, you know, we had a prescribed fire on the north side of the road. We have a wildland fire use on the south side of the road, and then we're suppressing fires 4 to 5 miles away to the west of this area. And I mean, being able to do all three of those at once at that time, I thought was pretty awesome.
First, I would say that it was a good place, you know, ponderosa pine, a good system of roads, access, not a lot of urban interface, kind of back 40, and we had a good plan and persons to implement the plan, support from persons, you know, throughout the forest and the region.
When I think back on my career, that was probably some of the most valuable learning I had, was to watch people and to work with people who had just a high level of professionalism and prescribed fire skills and understood the ecology and understood how to put out firing patterns and spread people out and cover a lot of ground and get a lot of good results on the ground. I mean, that laboratory, to be part of that and to watch that and participate was, I mean, it was probably the pinnacle of my career.
I kind of like to think that fire is a resource too, you know. It was in this landscape in the past. We were able to get it back on the landscape now, but I think we need to always continually looking at fire as a resource.